Good morning, everybody. It's so good to see you this morning. We have a very exciting way to kick off the service this morning. So if you will, go ahead and have a seat because we're going to make our way right over to the baptistry because we get to kick off this morning's service with a baptism. So how awesome is that? So Sherry, are you ready? All right, go ahead and open up, guys. This is Sherry. We are just so excited that we get to start off today's service with a baptism. I've got to visit with Sherry, and she is so thankful, grateful to be here. I've got to visit with her about her faith and her trust in the Lord. And so we thought, what a better way of kicking off a service, even before we sing, even before we worship, before we do any of that stuff, we're going to start it off with a baptistry, right? All right. So, Sherry, are you ready? Okay. All right. Won't you hang on to there? Right there? Okay. All right, Sherry. Because of your profession of faith, in obedience to the Lord's command that we baptize believers as his disciples, I baptize you now, my sister, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost.
All right.
You can't start off a service any better than that, can you? What a great day to be together. As we begin this time of worship, let's go to the Lord in prayer as we commit this time to him. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this day. We thank you for Sherry, the commitment that she has to place her faith and trust in Jesus Christ. Lord, we're just so grateful for your salvation that you have brought near to us through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Now, as we enter into this time of worship, Lord, I pray that you would remove all those distractions from our heart and life that pull our attention away from you. We want to worship you, Jesus. We want to sing your praises. So, Lord, be with us now in this place. Guide us and direct us. May our hearts and our thoughts and our minds be pointed upwards to you. We love you, Lord, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. And happy Father's Day to the dads that are here today. Good to see everybody here this morning. Out of Psalms 9, I'm going to read real quickly. I will give thanks to you, Lord, with all my heart. I will tell of all of your wonderful deeds, and I will be glad and rejoice in you, and I will sing the praises of your name, O Most High. And we're going to do that this morning, starting out our worship with, Oh, How I Love Jesus.
A name I love to hear, I love to sing its worth. It sounds like music in my ear, the sweetest name on earth. Oh, how I love Jesus! Oh, how I love Jesus! Oh, how I love Jesus! Because he first loved me, it tells me of a Savior's love who died to set me free. It tells me of his precious Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me. Shadows in the light of you. When I found the joy of reaching your heart, when my will becomes enthralled in your love, when all things that surround become shadows in the light of you. Worship you, I worship you. The reason I live is to worship you. I worship you.
Here is here, you are one desire.
Let our shout be your anthem, your renown. Fill the sky, we are here for you. We are here for you. Let your word move in power. Let what's dead come to life. We are here for you. We are here for you. Our minds are open, nothing here is hidden. You are our one desire. You alone are holy, only you are worthy. God, let your fire fall down. You are
here in your arms, I know what I
I don't have to carry the weight of who I've been, 'cause I'm forgiven. When I don't fit in and I don't feel like I belong anywhere, when I don't measure up too much in this life, oh, I'm a treasure in the arms of Christ.
Hallelujah.
'Cause I'm forgiven. I'm forgiven. And I don't have to carry the weight through my pain, 'cause I'm forgiven.
Glad we have a forgiving Father who is always faithful to us. Hallelujah. Yes.
Deliverer,
may be seated.
Jesus.
Good morning. Jesus is the hope of the world. Praise God. Happy Father's Day, everybody. For all of those dads who are here, who have got your kids up and drug them to church on Sunday morning, thank you for making the Lord a priority. Thank you for making the Word of God a priority. And for all of you dads who may have kids who maybe they're not walking close to the Lord right now, continue to pray for them. Because the fervent prayer of a believer doesn't fall on deaf ears. We have a God who listens, who hears our cries. And so if you have children who maybe they're not walking closely with the Lord right now, I just want to pray with you and encourage you to continue praying for those loved ones that you have, whether it's kids or grandkids, that they walk with the Lord. As we've been studying in the book of Luke, we've been working through passage after passage where it reveals the truth of Jesus Christ, who has come to seek and to save the lost. Last week, we jumped in and we talked about this interesting dinner party that a Pharisee threw. And he had a party for Jesus. He invited Jesus to come to this dinner party. And then we have the party crasher, the wicked woman, who shows up and she comes to the party that the Pharisee is having. And we realize that the Pharisee had basically completely ignored all of the standard customs and common courtesy of the day for Jesus. He hadn't provided water to wash. He hadn't provided oil. He didn't even really greet him with customary greeting. And instead of welcoming Jesus, he almost ignores him at his very own party. And then in walks the woman who is completely broken over her sin, who falls down at the feet of Jesus, weeping over her sin, her brokenness, crying at the feet of Jesus, washes his feet, anoints them with oil. And we realize in this story, the person who recognizes they have a great debt to pay loves the Lord very much. And the person that doesn't think they've got a whole lot to be forgiven of really doesn't appreciate or love the Lord. See, the woman recognized her great debt. The Pharisee, he's like, I'm really not that bad. And we realize that it's the people that recognize who they are before a holy God that have a great love for Jesus, have a great love for God. Well, as we continue on in the book of Luke, we now enter to this phase of where Jesus is going around in the general area and preaching around the Galilee, once again, his second tour of Galilee, if you will. He's going to continue on spreading the message of the gospel. And he has sent his disciples out, and they are proclaiming the word of God. And we've seen a multitude of different responses now. For instance, last week, Jesus' message went out to two different people, but they responded very differently. One responds with, wow, I need Jesus. I am broken. I'm so full of love and appreciation and gratitude. And the other one is just kind of sitting there like, just kind of keep him at arm's length. And so now Jesus explains there are different responses to the message of the gospel. There are going to be a great variety of responses, and we're probably familiar with this passage known as the sower and the seed. Now, before we jump into it too much, are there any gardeners in the room today? Come on, hold your hand up. Don't be ashamed. Yeah, nice and high. Susan's got a garden, and I see several hands going up here. We have several gardeners in the room. And so we're going to talk about what it means to grow a garden periodically throughout the service. So as you have your Bible, go ahead and flip it open to the book of Luke, Luke chapter 8, and we're going to begin reading in verse 4. Now, before we do, I want to make one thing real clear, because it should go without being said. Jesus' goal, God's goal, his mission on earth, always has been and always will be the proclamation of the gospel to the lost. It always was, and it continues to be, through his church, the proclamation of the good news of Jesus Christ. Death, burial, resurrection, justification, and sanctification. This is the message of the gospel. Always has been, always will be. Jesus preached it, the disciples were sent out to proclaim it, and now you and I get to participate in the continuing of the practice and the mission and the spread of the gospel. This is the message and the mission of Christ. Always has been, always will be. So as we begin in chapter 8, beginning in verse 4, it says, "As a large crowd was gathering, and people were flocking to him from every town, he said in a parable, 'A sower went out to sow his seed. And as he was sowing, some fell along the path. It was trampled on, and the birds of the sky ate it up. Other seed fell along the rock. And when it sprang up, it withered, since it lacked moisture. Other seed fell among the thorns. The thorns sprang up, and it choked it. Still, other seed fell along on good ground. And when it sprang up, it produced a crop 100 times what was sown.'" And as he said this, he called out, "Anyone who has ears to hear, you should listen." Then his disciples asked him, "What does this parable mean?" So he said, "The secret of the kingdom of God has been given to you to know, but to the rest it is in parables, so that looking they may not see, and hearing they may not understand." This is the meaning of the parable. The seed is the word of God. The seed along the path are those who have heard, and then the devil comes and takes away the word from their hearts so that they may not believe and be saved. And the seed on the rock are those who, when they hear, they welcome the word with joy. But having no root, these believe for a while and depart in a time of testing. As for the seed that fell among the thorns, these are the ones who, when they have heard, go on their way and are choked with worries and riches and pleasures of life and produce no mature fruit. But the seed in the good ground, these are the ones who, having heard the word with an honest and good heart, hold on to it, and by enduring bear fruit. No one, after lighting a lamp, covers it with a basket or puts it under a bed, but puts it on a lampstand so that those who come in may see its light. For nothing is concealed that won't be revealed, and nothing hidden that won't be made known and come to light. Therefore, take care how you listen. For whoever has, more will be given to him. Whoever does not have, even what he thinks he has, will be taken away from him." As we begin our time in the Word, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for your Word, for the power that's found in it, for the truth. Lord, I pray that the Word of God finds good soil today. Prepare each and every single one of our hearts to hear and to receive the word of God. Lord, I pray that you would work in our hearts. Reveal your truth to us. Reveal the promises and make us more like Christ. Lord, may your words be proclaimed. May your truth be told in this place. May the message of the gospel be clearly seen and heard. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Parable is an interesting thing. It means to lay something down that matches one another. Have you ever played the matching game with your kids or grandkids where you lay out all the cards on the ground and you have to flip them over and you're trying to find the pair that matches up? Essentially, that is a parable. He's laying down a story, but it has a matching meaning. Now, if you think about it, Jesus had just walked around and he tells this story about a sower went out to sow a field, okay? Pretty simple. He said, this farmer, he went out here, he cast some seed over there, he cast some seed over here. Some of it grew, some of it didn't, some of it was eaten. And the disciples are probably all standing there like, yes. And what's the big story about? Because John did that last week, and Simon did it the day before, and Andrew's going to do that tomorrow. That's what happens to seed. Some of it falls here, some of it falls there, some of it grows, some of it doesn't. Wow. And Jesus begins to reveal something. He says, if you got ears, pay attention. There's some deep truth here. Nothing surprising in the story. We see it played out every single day of our lives when people go out to plant. But there's a deep truth here that the Lord wants us to know. So if you have ears, hey, pay attention. There's something that the Lord would have us to know. Because when he preaches in parables, there's something that we are to do. We are to look at it, to ponder it, to gaze into it, and it makes us, it draws us to respond. It demands a response of us. You can't look at a parable and simply say, oh, that's nice. It's going to cause us to think. And we shouldn't walk away unchanged. We should respond. When we hear the message of the Lord spoke, then we are to be drawn into it and we are to respond to it. So the question that is being addressed in this parable is simply this. How will people respond when they hear the message of the gospel? That's the question that he's getting at. Because as I said, Jesus has gone out, he's preached, he sent his disciples out, and as they've gone out and they preached, and just like we talked about last week, Simon the Pharisee was sitting there, he heard the message of the gospel, he's heard the good news of the kingdom, one of them didn't respond, but the sinner, the lady, she did. How will you respond when you hear the word of Christ? What will you do? Because there's a variety of different responses. So we're going to do a little game today. It's Jeopardy. And so instead of giving you the answer, I'm going to give you the question. Number one, the seed, what is the word of God? You have to answer it with a question, right? The seed, fill in the blank, what is the word of God? Jesus makes it clear. This is the message of the gospel. This is the word of God going forth. It is the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. This is the kingdom of God has come to earth. The kingdom of God is here. Repent and believe the good news. We read in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, beginning in verse 3, it says, "For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures, that he appeared to Cephas and to the 12. Jesus Christ came to the earth, he lived, and he died for me and you." This is the gospel. And the gospel is continuing to work today. It is continuing to change and renew people's hearts and lives. And this is what he is saying. When people hear the message of Jesus Christ, not everybody's going to respond the same way. Not everybody will receive it in the same way. Some of the people who hear it, it'll land on good soil. Some on hard, some on thorny, some on rocky soil, and some it will never even begin to grow. So, number two, the soil. The question is, who receives the word? Who receives the word? Before we jump into this too much, I want to just point something out. Preaching is not intended to be an active role for the preacher, and a passive role for the listener. It is intended for the preacher to read, proclaim, to declare the word of God, and for all those who are hearing the word of God to enter into the throne room of God together. We are all entering into his presence, listening and hearing what the Lord has for us today. Every single one of us are called to engage in the word of God. This is not action on this part and passive on this part. We are all called to enter into the throne of grace. We are all called to engage in this communication and fellowship with him. So it is not intended to be a one-way street. All of us are engaged to step into the throne room of God. So do you have ears? Hey, listen up. It's time to listen. Pay attention. Let's engage. So let's look at these four types of soil. Number one, the hard soil. The seed that does nothing. It can't grow. Did you notice that? It's not even given a chance. It falls along the path. The birds pick it up. And Jesus says this is when the devil is at work in that person's heart to where the word of God simply will not take root. The word is snatched. The devil is at work in and around that person's heart and their life to the point where it hinders and prevents them from receiving the message of the gospel. Have you ever been engaged in telling somebody the work of Christ or maybe your story, how God has worked in you, and it's just this blank stare or a complete disinterest in what God has done? Let me tell you what's going on there. Spiritual warfare. That's spiritual warfare at work. The devil is working hard to prevent them from hearing and receiving the message of the gospel. That is spiritual warfare at work. See, we are not engaged simply in flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers and against the dark rulers of this world. This is spiritual warfare that we are engaged in. And so when we face somebody, we're engaged in conversation with somebody, I don't want us to mislabel or misunderstand the true enemies of the gospel. The true enemies of the gospel are not various political parties. It is not different agendas, people and groups of this group or that group. Label them what you will. That are the true enemies of the gospel is Satan. And it may be disguised in all sorts of different forms, but it is the devil that is working hard to prevent people from entering the kingdom of God. Don't mislabel the work of the devil. The devil is working hard to prevent people from entering the kingdom. And if that is true, then before you open your mouth to proclaim the message of the gospel, you better engage in prayer. Amen. Say, Lord, as I begin to proclaim your word, as I begin to proclaim what Jesus has done for me in my heart and my life, Lord, be at work here. Because it's not about how good and polished my words come out. It's about the Lord preparing my heart, the Lord preparing others' hearts to receive the message of the gospel. So engage in prayer. The second thing, the seed that falls on rock or on shallow ground. This is a Christian who has no understanding or biblical knowledge, no understanding of the true work of Jesus Christ on the cross. No understanding of the depth of the message of salvation. There is no root to hold them when the things and pressures of this life come along. I'm sure that there's nobody here who's ever experienced a trying moment of your faith, right? That doesn't happen, right? You see, yeah, wrong. If the devil can't prevent you from coming to Christ, then the next best thing is to prevent you from growing in Christ. You see, he would love to prevent you from entering into the kingdom. He would love to snatch your soul. But if he can't stop you there, then he most certainly will do all he can from prevent you from growing in him. There is a very real truth that's being revealed here. One of the tactics that the devil loves to use, and I think one of his most powerful weapons, is a shallow church. A group of believers that maybe know the message of salvation, but they have no root. They have no depth of understanding. A church that cannot stand in the face of a storm. A church that gets pushed around by the winds and politics and sin and the agenda of this world and this culture. A church that has no root will get pushed around by any whim that society says you need to fall for. Just recently, a group of churches, a certain church, I won't say which one, had a convention that gathered people together. And as they got up, these preachers, I say that carefully, got up and introduced themselves as she, her, he, him, gay, lesbian, binary, trans, all these sort of things. That is a church with no root. That is a church that is getting blown and pushed by the society. That is a church that is falling for sin. That is a church that has absolutely nothing to stand on. They're going to fall for anything. We must be a group of believers that are rooted in the Word of God. We must be a church of families, moms, dads, sons, daughters who are rooted in Jesus Christ, Him crucified, and upon the Word of God and God alone. We do not fall for the wind of sin. Just because society says we should go this way, you don't follow it. Stand upon the Word. Remain steadfast upon the Word of God, regardless of what the culture says you should do, should look like, dress like, act like, talk like. Stand upon the Word of God. May we all, each and every single one of us, be men and women of faith who are firmly rooted upon the Word of God. This is what it means to have a church that won't be blown around by the wind. Just a few weeks ago, we talked about John the Baptist, and Jesus said, did you go out to see a preacher who's going to get pushed around by the wind? Is it like a reed? No. You saw a man with conviction who knew what he believed, and he stood for it. May we be a church that knows what we believe and stand for it, not blown by the wind. We are not to be people who simply hears the message of the gospel, oh, I love Jesus, but when this pressure of life comes along, we fall for anything. Like I said before, Susan's got a garden. Grows all sorts of things. Flowers. She grows some corn, tomatoes, all sorts of different things. Sometimes my kids like to go out there and they like to pick some of the different flowers. Put them in a vase, bring it inside, set it in a stand for a while. And it's really pretty for a few days, but eventually they wither up and die. But if you were to take that flower and cut it off and stick it in that same soil right next to the plant that it was growing next to, like if you just put the exact same soil, it won't last a single day in the heat. Why? Because it has no root. You've got to have a root and know where you sit in the Word of God. Know what the Bible says and be rooted in Him. Which brings us to number three. These are the seeds who fall into thorns. This is the distracted heart. It's the busy heart. It's the heart that is full of other things. The life that is so full of things that it has no room for Christ to grow in them. They begin to grow. They even appear to have what it takes to be fruitful for the kingdom of God. But Jesus says the worries and the riches and the pleasures of this life choke it out. You see, a gardener doesn't only love the plants that they're planting. And they plant all the seeds, the vegetables and the crops and all this sort of things, and they're growing in the garden. They don't only love the plants, but you have to have a healthy disdain for the weeds. The question is, Christian, what weeds are growing in your life? What have you allowed to creep in to grow in your heart and life that is choking out your heart, your life, for being productive for the kingdom of God? Notice this doesn't say anything about the soil. In fact, it seems like it's good soil. So good, in fact, that other things grow up. It's not a matter of that it can't produce a good crop, a good fruit. The problem is what else is with it. You see, we get so caught up in the things and the riches and the worries and the pleasures of this world that we fail to recognize this is all so temporal, and we don't realize that what really matters is eternal. If we were more focused on our eternal dwelling and less focused upon the here and now, what makes me happy today, maybe we produce more fruit. You see, the problem is we are so caught up with the things of this world and this life, it chokes out the ability to produce good fruit. 1 John chapter 2, verse 15 says, do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For everything in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride in one's possessions is not from the Father, but it is from the world. And the world with its lust is passing away. But the one who does the will of God remains forever. You cannot be sold out for God and sold out for the world. It's one or the other. So Christian, what do you need to get weeded out of your heart? You need to have a pretty good hoe to pull up those weeds, or some pretty good weed killer to zap whatever has been growing in your heart and your life that has no business in the life of a Christian. Not only a love for the Lord, but a disdain for what is evil. Let's keep going, which brings us to number four, the good soil. He says, by enduring, they bear fruit. By enduring. And I think this is interesting. It doesn't just happen to grow by accident. This is the one who does not fall where the devil has snatched them up. The one who has sunk the root in. The one who is not choked out by the things of this life. And they endure the hardship. They can take the heat. Because they have that root, they can take the heat. They can endure. It does not simply grow. Also, the word of God does not simply grow for the benefit of one's self. You notice that? Think about it. A seed, when you put it in the ground, doesn't grow just in order for the tree or the shoot or the plant to look nice. What does it do? It produces more seed. If Susan were to go up to the hardware store and to find a package of corn, start reading the label on the back, it says, boy, it grows super tall, super green, looks great, but produces no fruit. Is she going to plant that? Man, I hope not. Find a nice package of tomatoes. It's supposed to be maybe those little cherry tomatoes. And it's got a really nice plant, a really great root, but absolutely no fruit involved. Are you going to plant that? Why would you have that? See, the Lord intends for us to produce fruit. This is what it means to be a follower of Jesus Christ, is to follow him to produce fruit for the kingdom of God. The first three soils represent the three primary enemies of a Christian: the world, the flesh, and the devil. These are all opposed to the word of God. This is why we are engaged in spiritual warfare. John 17:17 says this, sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth. As you sent me into the world, I also have sent them into the world. Which brings us to point number three. It is the Lord. Who determines the harvest? It is the Lord. Now here's an interesting and I think a reassuring truth about the gospel. It is not, the success of the gospel is not determined by the skill of the sower. Think about it. It is not determined by the skill of the sower, the guy who plants. What is he called to do? Plant! Cast the seed. But guess what? It's not going to grow if you keep the seed in your pocket. Amen. You got to plant the seed. But the success of the gospel is not determined upon me, and it's not determined upon you. It's determined upon him. Yes. Praise the Lord. Yes. We are called to plant. See, some plant, some water, but it's the Lord who gives the increase. Praise God that we are called to participate in the message of sharing the gospel. And it's not, the gospel success is not dependent upon me, praise the Lord. Are there any farmers in the room? Farmers in the room, you know what I'm talking about? People who have driven the tractor and the combine. Okay, any of your grandparents were farmers? How about that? Did any of you have a grandparent who was a farmer? Okay, a couple of you guys. My grandfather lived up in southwestern Iowa. In southwestern Iowa, That's some good corn country. It grows tall, it grows green, and they have huge crops of corn. And I remember going there as a kid, getting to ride on the tractor and the combine and standing up in the front window and watching all the harvest take place. It was great to see the harvest in southwestern Iowa. It was incredible. As a kid, loved it. In Lafayette County, the average corn field can produce about 176 bushels an acre. Not bad. Pretty good produce of corn. But that's nothing compared to Iowa, where they can get well over 200 bushels per acre. See, it would be silly, though, for a farmer in Lafayette County to say, I'm not going to plant because it doesn't produce like that. It's silly for a Christian to say, I'm not going to spread the gospel because I'm not sure that it'll produce like that. We are called to preach the word. Send out the message of the gospel and let God do the work. Let the Lord determine where that falls, whether it's on a soft heart or one that's ready to receive the word. But you and I are called to share the message of Jesus Christ and Him crucified. This is what we are called to do as believers. It's so silly to say, I'm not going to plant the word of God because I don't know how it's going to be heard. Ridiculous. Plant the word of God. What brings us to number four, the sower. And here's really a question. Who shares the word? It should be the sower. It should be us. Do you plant the gospel? Do you share the gospel? Because it's pretty obvious that only the people whose heart is tender for the things of the Lord, only the person who grows and produces crops, those people can share the gospel. If your faith is choked out, how are you going to spread the word? If your faith is getting tangled up by the thick cares and the worries and the pleasures and all the things of this world, then how are you going to share the gospel? You must have a tender heart towards the Lord. So do you share the gospel? And it must be the gospel according to Scripture. So often, far too often, there are versions of Scripture, versions of the gospel that water the gospel down. Come to Jesus and your life will be good. Come to Jesus and He'll make sure that you're never in lack. Let me tell you, my riches are just out of view. It's not a version of the gospel that says you come to Jesus and you're never going to suffer again. What sort of gospel is that? Let me be honest with you. I've known some Christians that have faced some pretty severe persecution. That's the gospel. The promise of the gospel is not to make this life easy. It's that He will walk with you every step of the way from now and to all eternity. The message of the gospel must not be watered down. It must not become a version that is more suitable to my needs. See, this is the problem that we have. We live in a culture and a society today that wants to take the word of God and twist it to make it fit their agenda, my agenda, your agenda. Don't do that. You fit in the Bible's agenda. You follow the word of God alone, nothing else. So here's the true question. Are you a sower? Have you sowed the word of God? Has it taken root in your heart? Or do you not have a root? Maybe you understand the message of Jesus Christ and Him crucified, but you've never sunk your root into the Word of God to know what it says. To really understand the work of Jesus Christ, which is designed to radically change and transform your heart and life. Or maybe you're getting choked out by the cares and the worries and the riches and the pleasures of this life, and you're not able to grow. You're not able to produce fruit. Or is your heart tender towards the Lord? And are you sowing the word of God? Because here is the gospel. Jesus came to this earth and died for fallen humanity. Each and every single one of us are sinners, depraved, separated from God and rebelling against God from birth. But Jesus made a way. Jesus came to this earth, lived the life that I could not live, and died the death that I could not die in order to give me redemption. And guess what? Jesus didn't stay dead. He rose after 3 days, and now he sits at the right hand of the throne of God, waiting to return to bring his church back to him. Jesus provided a way. And it's not just so that you're not sent to hell. It's also to begin a transformational work in your heart and your life while you're alive here on this earth. That's called sanctification. Be made more and more like Jesus. This is the message of the gospel. Do you know it? Has it taken root in your heart? And are you sharing it with others? The youth are getting ready to go on a missions trip in a place where they're going to have all sorts of opportunities to share their faith. And I dare say, if they share their faith often enough, and if you share your faith often enough, you're going to run into all four types of soil. You're going to find somebody whose eyes are blind and their heart is closed to receive the message of the gospel. You're going to find those who are willing and ready to accept it quickly, jump on board, but they sink no root. Then there are those who receive the word of God, but they are distracted by the things of this life. But some, that message will fall on good soil. So continue to share the message of Christ. Let me tell you, praise God it's not dependent upon you, and praise God it's not dependent upon me. The message of the gospel can be simple. What has God done in your life? Share it. Share that message. Share what Jesus has done for me. Share what Jesus has done for you. That is the good news of Jesus. This is what he does here on earth. You see, we have a great Lord, a loving God, who sent his son to die for all the sin of all mankind, for all those who would place their faith and trust in him. So dads, how's your heart? Is it soft soil? Or is it shallow? Or are you allowing things to grow that have no business in the heart of a Christian? Are you on good soil today? Also, are you preparing your children's heart to receive the message of the gospel? Because let's be honest, dads, what we set as priority in our life often gets transferred to our kids is what they think should be priority in their life. And if I've got a hard heart, a shallow heart, a things that's not interested in the things of the Lord, what am I modeling and displaying for my kids is acceptable? If I'm wanting to my kids to come to know the Lord and place their trust in him, how's my heart? How's your heart? Is it a place where the gospel can grow, it can take root, it can challenge and change you? Because here's the amazing and terrifying reality. I get to help cultivate the heart of my kids to hear the message of God. It's amazing. And it's terrifying. Because God would use a fallen sinner like me to share the greatest message ever been told. Praise God for who he is. Praise God for the work of Jesus Christ on the cross, that we can participate in the message of the gospel. And I pray that it has found good soil today. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father,